27-year-old lady presented to the hospital with acute onset right-sided facial weakness. The right side of her face had several key signs, such as inability to blink, drooping of the mouth, the disappearance of the nasolabial fold, and absence of forehead wrinkles when she was asked to look up. She also complained of a lack of tearing in the right eye and altered taste sensations. A key clinical feature of Bell's palsy is the progressive nature of the weakness. Its onset occurs in a day or two, reaches the maximum weakness in 3 weeks or less, and shows signs of recovery within 6 months. This is how a classic case of facial nerve palsy presents to the doctors. The most likely cause for this syndrome is indeed Bell's palsy, but it's a diagnosis of exclusion. We need to exclude other causes of facial nerve palsy before establishing the diagnosis of Bell's palsy. That's why doctors perform a full neurological examination and a physical examination in each patient. Okay, let me explain the basis of the symptoms. The facial nerve originates in the pons. Its motor fibers supply the facial muscles via 5 branches. Any damage to the nerve will result in paralysis of these muscles. Sensory fibers bring taste signals from the anterior 2/3 of the tongue. This explains the altered taste sensations in our patients. The facial nerve's parasympathetic neurons innervate the lacrimal glands and salivary glands. This results in dry eyes and dry mouth. Without tears, eyes are prone to ulcerations and infections. On its course, the facial nerve passes through a narrow structure called the facial canal. If there was a swelling of the facial nerve here, it can lead to compression of the nerve. This canal is a common site for facial nerve injuries, including Bell's palsy. Histopathology studies have shown that herpes simplex reactivation accounts for the majority of cases of Bell's palsy. Unfortunately, there's no way to confirm this in clinical practice. When other possible causes of facial nerve palsy are ruled out, we can establish the clinical diagnosis of Bell's palsy. Two of the major risk factors are diabetes and pregnancy. Diabetes causes focal ischemia of the facial nerve, making it more susceptible to facial nerve palsies. Pregnancy-related fluid retention can increase the risk of facial nerve compression at the facial canal. Doctors usually diagnose Bell's palsy only with clinical findings, but there are 3 instances where investigations can be useful. 1. Brain imaging may be useful if doctors suspect other causes, like strokes or pontine lesions. 2. Electromyography studies may be used to assess the prognosis in clinically complete lesions. 3. Serological studies for Lyme disease are recommended in Lyme endemic areas, especially in the presence of bilateral facial nerve palsies. Treatment is multidisciplinary. In the acute stage, we start the patients with an oral steroid like prednisone for 1 week period. We often add antivirals like acyclovir or valacyclovir if the weakness is severe. If the eyes cannot be closed properly, artificial eye drops are recommended. During sleep, eyes can be carefully taped shut using medical-grade tapes. During the daytime, protective glasses can be used to minimize eye damage. Physical therapies like electrical stimulation of the facial muscles can be arranged to help the recovery. Though this practice is not supported by high-quality research data, many doctors, including some of the cleverest neurologists I've worked under, still continue to prescribe physiotherapy, especially when the recovery is prolonged. Thanks for watching. I'll see you soon with another interesting medical case.